In the wake of what is coming to be considered the Asian century, the global world order is witnessing a reorientation of economic activity away from the West and towards the East, in addition to growing social, cultural, and political hegemony across a variety of Asian nations. Whilst the notion of the Asian century largely correlates with the rise of China as a superpower, second to that of the United States, neighboring countries to China, such as South Korea or India, are equally vital actors in facilitating the rise of the Asian century. Writing in the context of the COVID-19 pandemic, the Singaporean diplomat and geopolitical consultant Kishore Mahbubani declares in his book named The Asian 21st Century that history has turned a corner. The era of Western domination is ending. The resurgence of Asia in world affairs and the global economy, which was happening before the emergence of COVID-19, will be cemented in a new world order after the crisis. The deference to Western societies, which was the norm in the 19th and 20th centuries, will be replaced by growing respect and admiration for East Asian ones. The West's incompetent response to the pandemic will hasten the power shift to the East and herald the dawn of the Asian century. According to Mahbubani, the Asian century will dethrone the hegemony of the West, particularly that of the United States as a global monopolizing superpower. Asian societies will subsequently become a great source of inspiration for other nations across the world to emulate. Whilst greater technological and economic interdependence, spearheaded from Asia to the rest of the world, will spur greater efforts in furthering globalization and establishing an interconnected global village of sorts. In Mahbubani's own optimistic words, when future historians look at the 21st century, they will marvel at how many big changes happened in the human condition in such a small space of time. Certainly most vital to the prominence of rising Asian nations are developments in modern technologies and the further integration of such technologies into East Asian societies as a part of defining modernization in the 21st century. Technological advancements in the Asian continent can be observed in the likes of Japan and Singapore's social integration of robots, Taiwan's proficient semiconductor industry, South Korea's 3D advertising and first virtual influencer, and in China's extensive AI research and 5G capacities. Technological advancements in relation to the global dominance of neoliberal capitalism across the Asian continent has not only resulted in East Asian societies inheriting such final technological assemblies, but additionally becoming the very producers and users of such technologies themselves. A profound Western capitalist emphasis on the East as the center of mass production and assembling of products for consumers in the West has shaped Western-Eastern dichotomy since China opened its economy to the global free market and sought to utilize its vast labor pool for cheap manufacturing to spur foreign investment and rapid economic growth in the late 20th century. Other East Asian nations prior to China's opening up prioritized domestic manufacturing and industrious technological acquisition through protectionist economic policies. The paradigms of East Asia as being both producers and integrators of modern technologies has facilitated largely modern Western understandings of the East as a more technocentric civilization, upon which the broader East Asian population and their infrastructural dwellings are endowed with more machine-like qualities, either in terms of advanced techno-progression or techno-nihilistic regression. Nonetheless, this conception of a technologized East draws directly from neo-Orientalist framings, upon which the distinctions between human characteristics and machine-like characteristics are seemingly blurred. This neo-Orientalist framing is more accurately defined as Techno-Orientalism, which was first coined by the cultural studies scholars David Morley and Kevin Robbins in 1995. According to the authors of Techno-Orientalism, Imagining Asia in Speculative Fiction, History and Media, Techno-Orientalism is defined as the phenomenon of imagining Asia and Asians in hyper-technological terms, in cultural productions and political discourse. Techno-Orientalist imaginations are infused with the language and codes of the technological and the futuristic. These developed alongside industrial advances in the West and have become part of the West's project of securing dominance as architects of the future, a project that requires configurations of the East as the very technology with which to shape it. Techno-Orientalist speculations of an Asianized future have become ever more prevalent in the wake of neoliberal trade policies that enabled greater flow of information and capital between the East and the West. The specter of Asian roboticism and a technologized East is not only indebted to the onset of Asian factory production and Chinese labor, but is further indebted to the contemporary hyperreal presentation of globally observable, well-choreographed K-pop idols, adherence to strict Confucian capitalist workplace environments, and in sophisticated pandemic control and mass surveillance systems, which seemingly contrasts a more individualized, free market West, which is falling behind the East in terms of technological, infrastructural, and economic advancements. First initiated by anxieties regarding the rise of the Japanese economy in the 1970s and 80s, Techno-Orientalism came to permeate throughout American popular culture, from the novel named Neuromancer and films such as Blade Runner, which emulated the monolithic city structure of Tokyo, to The Matrix, Cloud Atlas, Ex Machina, and more recently Ghost in the Shell, and Blade Runner 2042, all of which, to varying extents, envisioned characters or settings possessing an advanced sense of Asianness. As Keisha Ishino declares, when a dystopian future with extremely advanced technology pops up in movies, the Asianness of the scene is almost always over-exaggerated, so much that in most circumstances, the directors don't even bother to fact-check the very different cultures of East Asia and just cluster it all into one abomination of Japanese, Chinese, and Hangul characters on billboards. The vision of an advanced, culturally amalgamated, neon-light strobing Asianized dystopian future would come to be a defining feature of the cyberpunk genre, which was most recently characterized in the video game named Cyberpunk 2077. The image most typically associated with cyberpunk techno-orientalism is that of the projected geisha image, symbolizing both an aesthetically captivating East to be gazed upon and its pure exoticized otherness or difference to the West, as mediated through a hazy hologram billboard projection, further emphasizing the conjunction between technology, capitalism, hyperreality, and Asianness. Whilst technological advancements across East Asia have developed in tandem with higher levels of state intervention, authoritarian practices, and biopolitical systems of control, any narrative or understanding pertaining to roboticism or techno-nihilism in Asia serves almost by default, even if not intended, in the context of the East-West divide, to reify pre-existing disparities between what is considered Eastern and Western, with Westernness typically coming to present itself as something either unbound from the seemingly machine-like qualities of the East, or in most cases, as something inevitably bound to be swept up by the currents of Asian technology, contributing to a sense of decadence and alienating hyperreality, as a part of the broader notion of a perceived Western decline. Unlike the traditional Orientalism first formulated by the Palestinian-American philosopher Edward Said, the lens through which the otherness of the East was forged was largely concerted by the West itself. However, the techno-orientalism of the 21st century arises from and relies heavily on the interplay between both the West and the East in the facilitation of global neoliberal and state capitalist systems of hierarchical power. As the co-authors declare, whereas traditional Orientalism, as a strategy of representational containment, arrests Asia in traditional and often pre-modern imagery, techno-orientalism presents a broader dynamic and often contradictory spectrum of images constructed by the East and West alike of an Orient undergoing rapid economic and cultural transformations. Techno-orientalism, like traditional Orientalism, places great emphasis on the project of modernity, stretching beyond traditional Orientalism's premise of a hegemonic West's representational authority over the East. Techno-orientalism's scope is much more expansive and bidirectional. Its discourse is mutually constituted by the flow of trade and capital across the hemispheres. In other words, both Western and Eastern capitalists have a vested interest in maintaining techno-orientalist perspectives to ensure biopolitical control and the production and reproduction of capitalist hierarchies, albeit to serve differing interests of both Western and Eastern elites respectively. Perhaps in more disturbing acknowledgement, Asian individuals can now, to far greater extents, participate in their own subjection. Orientalism, as it was first professed by Edward Said, related Asian-centered Western imperialist conquests of the 19th and early 20th centuries to the constructions of the East or Orient, which justified and maintained Western hegemony and supremacy over the Orient. According to Said, Orientalism can be discussed and analyzed as the corporate institution for dealing with the Orient, dealing with it by making statements about it, authorizing views of it, describing it, by teaching it, settling it, ruling over it. In short, Orientalism as a Western style for dominating, restructuring and having authority over the Orient. For Said, the Napoleonic conquests of Egypt in the late 18th and early 19th century was a prime example of a largely epistemologically orientated imperial conquest, which contrasted European imperial conquests of annihilation, as epitomized in the 16th century Spanish conquests of the Americas, as the French conquest under Bonaparte was not only made up of soldiers on Egyptian soil, but was additionally made up of botanists, architects, philologists, biologists, and historians, who produced a form of knowledge on Egypt to the behest of French and other European imperialists, at the expense of the Egyptians themselves. The earliest forms of Orientalism in this sense required not only military strength to impose a Western presence on Eastern land, but further required modern institutions to survey, construct, and disseminate knowledge on the Orient, to see in Eastern people what they could not see in themselves, and for which the Orient itself could not replicate such constructs of knowledge upon the West or Occident. Even to this day, our modern understandings of what is considered the East are historically indebted to such relations between power and knowledge acquisition. As Said reaffirms regarding linguistics, that after Napoleon's Egyptian expedition, Europe came to know the Orient more scientifically, to live in it with greater authority and discipline than ever before. But what mattered to Europe was the expanded scope and the much greater refinement given its techniques for receiving the Orient. When around the turn of the 18th century, the Orient definitively revealed the age of its languages, it was a group of Europeans who made the discovery, passed it on to other scholars, and preserved the discovery in the new science of Indo-European philology. A new powerful science for viewing the linguistic Orient was born, and with it, a whole web of related scientific interests. Most typical to Orientalist constructions of the East was that the Orient came to be seen as ancient but primitive, supine yet violent, materially excessive and luxurious, but morally degenerate. It was a seemingly mysterious land beholden to ancient tyrannical civilizations and made up of exotic peoples, languages, animals, buildings, and objects. This Western colonial understanding of the Orient helped to define the West in opposition to the East. Whilst the East was deemed irrational and scientifically uninformed, the West was deemed rational and scientifically informed. Whilst the East was deemed feminine, the West was deemed masculine. Whilst the East was deemed morally bankrupt and pagan, the West was deemed morally righteous, God-fearing, and Christian. And whilst the East was deemed ancient and servile, the West was deemed modern and merciful. The process of constructing the East, however, was not a random process, nor was it something understood only by a few elite Western scholars for a given period of time, but rather it was something in recent centuries that would come to permeate entire societies across the West to varying degrees. As the post-colonial lecturer, D. Elizabeth Glasgow declares, Orientalism argues that colonialism was not only a system of political rule, but an all-encompassing way of understanding the world, that simply believed the West was superior to the East. Said's work in Orientalism was designed to show that the academic world was closely connected to the system of political power, and was seeking to prove that academics had, in effect, collaborated in the West's domination of the East. This colonialist thinking did not go away when colonial rule ended in the mid to late 20th century, but continued in different forms. Following from the epistemological conquests of the East in the early 19th century, Orientalism would bring forth yellow peril narratives of an imagined hostile and cunning Asian superpower, which could challenge the imperial hegemony of the West, but would inevitably be overcome and subdued. The rise of communism in Asia in the mid-20th century would further exacerbate yellow peril narratives of a revolutionary communist East sweeping the globe and abolishing Western capitalist hegemony, pertaining credence to the communist domino theory. And by the late 20th century, notions of a despotic and terroristic East would give rise to an American-centric neo-Orientalism, which would present the East in terms of a place to be liberated and its values refashioned to the requirements of American neoliberal hegemony. Orientalism, in all of its abbreviated forms, ultimately denied the East the ability to define itself in its own terms and provided a network of knowledge upon the East to justify Western hegemony and/or military intervention in Asia. However, as first recognized in the late 20th century, a new technological approach to an American-centric neo-Orientalism was seemingly in its earliest stages of manifestation, as a technological upsurge from the East, most particularly Japan, in an era of expanding global neoliberalization, posed a seemingly real challenge to American corporate hegemony, in addition to a real potential sense of American economic decline. This branch of Neo-Orientalism, which would later be conceptualized as Techno-Orientalism, thus reshaped Orientalist discourse away from an explicit otherness or difference of the East, and towards a greater sense of uncanniness with the East, or more regionally specific, post-war capitalist East Asia. The anxieties of a modern Asian nation-state, surpassing the economic hegemony of the United States, could be observed in the anti-Japanese sentiment of the 1970s and 80s across a variety of American cities, from which Japanese automobile companies, such as Honda, Toyota, and Nissan, replaced declining American automobile companies, such as Ford and General Motors, as major global producers and disseminators of automobiles, which also correlated with the decline of traditional American blue-collar manufacturing and greater levels of American unemployment. As the historian M.J. Hale states, for many, Japan was the greatest threat to the United States. With the crumbling of the Soviet bloc, there was a growing conviction that a country's international status would be determined by its economic power, and it was the Japanese economy, rather than the American, that now appeared to be performing miracles. American resentment, particularly amongst its working-class population, was directed towards Japanese-made cars, and in worse cases, towards Asian Americans as a whole. As Hale also describes, in Michigan, anti-Japanese sentiment ran high. In cities like Flint and Lansing, there were reports of Japanese cars having windscreens broken and tires slashed. Detroit boasted parking lots with signs saying, "No Japanese cars allowed." A Chinese American was horrifically beaten to death with a baseball bat in Detroit by a pair of unemployed white auto workers who apparently took him to be Japanese and so responsible for their plight. Unique to American anxieties regarding Japan in the 1980s was that Japan held close geopolitical and economic ties to the United States as both a key military ally and trading partner. The modernity of post-war Japan, from which its technological upsurge would emerge, was also profoundly influenced by and based upon American economic models. And the United States played a vital role in directing and developing the ways in which post-war Japanese modernity would materialize. In this sense, Japan's technological rise is just as much a product of America's own post-war hegemony and global neoliberalization efforts as it is domestically Japanese. Japan itself would never come to surpass the United States economy, and Japan's economic miracle was short-lived, with the nation falling into a recession a decade later, which would come to define the last decade of the 20th century and the early 21st century as a period of the lost decades in Japanese history. In the Western imagination, however, Japanese technology and technologized infrastructure remains nonetheless a defining feature of a dystopian cyberpunk Asianized future. As the co-authors, Ro, Huang, and Yu suggest, the Japanese are technologically advanced and therefore culturally fascinating now because of past Western modernizing interventions in the Eastern sphere. The West has created a hyper-futuristic Japan, and in this vision, Japan is now, in a sense, more Western than the West, a simulacrum that threatens the foundational fiction of the West as future. The early 21st century would also see a growing Western interest on the rise of China as an emerging superpower comparable to that of the United States. China, which had modeled itself upon a fusion of Confucian statecraft and Western free market practices, all whilst being the global factory of Western consumerism, was seemingly coming to be seen as an economic competitor to the United States. Regarding China through the lens of American media in the early 2000s, the co-authors declare, in the early 21st century, the perceived economic threat of Japan and its automobiles had given way to China. Despite the fact that China does not have a particularly strong reputation as a high-tech nation, Techno-Orientalism's robust flexibility allows for seamless transplantation to another national site. China's rapid economic rise is largely credited to its vast manufacturing base, which, coupled with cheap labor and less regulation, has made it an attractive production location for many tech companies, including Apple and Dell. Although the vast majority of Chinese cannot afford the iPads and iPhones they produce, we see in US media a representational shift using techno-orientalist conventions, transforming Chinese from mindless workers to sinister agents. The sinister tropes which American media came to inscribe upon China's rise was epitomized by the fiscally conservative American advocacy group named Citizens Against Government Waste, which depicted Chinese global hegemonic supremacy in a political ad for the 2010 American midterm elections. The ad, titled "Chinese Professor Presents a Male Chinese Lecturer in the Year 2030, within a large futuristic lecture hall daubed with 20th century Maoist propaganda upon the wall, delivering a speech on the collapse of civilizations, as images of such fallen civilizations, including modern America, are depicted on the lecture screen. According to the Chinese lecturer, American civilization in this fictional timeline collapsed due to government spending, nationalized healthcare, higher taxes, and defaulting on Chinese debts, for which the Chinese lecturer smirks and declares that America now works for China.
古希腊、罗马帝国，不列颠帝国，美国，因为他们都犯同样的错误，与原来使得他们成功的原则背道而驰。美国政府企图以庞大的开支和税收来摆脱严重的经济衰退，巨额的所谓刺激开支，庞大的医疗改革，政府接管私有企业，债务累累。当然，我们是他们的大债主。<笑>现在他们都得给我们干活。<笑>
You can change the future. You have to. Join Citizens Against Government Waste to stop the spending that is bankrupting America.
With echoes of the most renowned 20th century Orientalist film saga, Fu Manchu, the Chinese professor embodies the specter of a technologically advanced and victorious Chinese superpower, which has not only replaced the United States as the leading hegemon, but has additionally transformed the United States into a subservient satellite state, and by inference, the American people too are defeated and dependent subjects to Chinese hegemony. The overall ideological message of the ad implies that only an anti-tax conservative American nation-state, which adheres to strictly free market principles, can defend its hegemony against the encroach of a rising China. In the current day, Orientalist American conservative and libertarian narratives on China, particularly seen from within the Trump MAGA base, further emphasize working and middle-class anxieties regarding economic outsourcing to China and present the Chinese state as the total antithesis to American values of freedom and liberty. Although the national actors and the details are quite different from the automobile industry of the 1980s, we have a similar techno-orientalist narrative. US jobs and manufacturing are being stolen by inorganic, technologically infused persons who threaten not only our economic, but humanistic integrity. China in recent years, especially since the outbreak of the COVID pandemic, has increasingly been perceived within the United States and across the broader Western world as a hyper-rationalized and mechanized draconian state, for which such machine-like qualities are not only reflected in Chinese technological advancements and industrial economic practices, but are reflected in state power, the military, urban infrastructure, pandemic control, and in most extreme cases, the people themselves, as docile state subjects. Acknowledgements of China's authoritarian and totalitarian practices, which are utilized to maintain China's state capitalist system, resulting in broader techno-nihilistic concerns, are not in themselves Orientalist or techno-Orientalist. However, to essentialize China and Chinese people without reflection upon globally systemic, technological practices or techno-nihilism in the West would be a clear indicator of crossing a fine line into Orientalist or techno-Orientalist ideas. This manner of thought is best reflected in a Twitter post made by the Canadian clinical psychologist Jordan Peterson, for which he retweeted and shared a post pertaining to a technologically charged form of BDSM pornography, which was initially declared to be a practice of the Chinese government's three-child policy. In Jordan Peterson's retweet of the post, he stated, "Such fun in unbelievable techno-nightmare CCP hell." It was, however, later revealed to be a porn video and porn dungeon from the United Kingdom, for which the participants in the video were British. Both the original post and Jordan Peterson's retweet unreflectively assumed that the men in the video were Chinese and therefore a part of some Chinese state breeding program. with the porn video perhaps reflecting the interior of a sterile Chinese manufacturing facility. Jordan Peterson and others came to possess such a techno-orientalist impression. Indeed, the specter of mass cheap labor in China has been a central point of invoking technologized perceptions of Asians, and Chinese people in particular, who are often contrasted in Western media with the redundant Western working classes, whose labor has been appropriated to China. According to Ishino, this view of Asians as an expendable labor force can be traced back to the Chinese Exclusion Act of 1882, where such things were claimed in court. Chinese laborers were built to withstand physical deprivations, but Americans were not. Chinese people were intelligent, but also obedient. Again, something Americans were apparently not. This historical understanding is also shared by the co-authors. As they declare, the US techno-orientalist imagination is thus rooted in this view of the Asian body as a form of expendable technology, a view that emerged in the discourse of early US industrialization and continued to evolve in the 20th century. This understanding can also be expanded to Europe, as the Allied powers of World War I recruited roughly 140,000 Chinese laborers to help maintain the war effort through manual labor close to the front lines. However, in contrast to the traditional Orientalism of the early 20th century, techno-orientalism of the early 21st century has thrived against a backdrop of global flows of capitalism, which requires not only the West, but the East itself to maintain the expendable biopolitical laboring Chinese or Asian body to produce the commodities necessary for neoliberal capitalist consumerism across the West. Such an economic relationship between, most specifically, the United States and China, is dialectical, with the West cementing its corporate consumer hegemony in labor facilities on Chinese soil, which has required the extensive mobilization of the Chinese laboring population, both skilled and unskilled, at the expense of raising China's economic activity and strength, as China has additionally acquired data and technological transfers from Chinese-based Western companies, which has provided the Chinese state the means to develop its own domestic techno-corporate hegemony. The discourse on China's rise in the US context, consistent with techno-orientalist contradictions, has focused on constructing its people as a vast subaltern-like labor force and as a giant consumer market whose appetite for Western cultural products, if nurtured, could secure US global cultural and economic dominance. Japan creates technology, but China is the technology. In the eyes of the West, both are crucial engines of the future. Japan innovates and China manufactures. And as Asia writ large becomes a greater consumerist force than the West, its threat value dualism commensurately increases. In this sense, the contradiction innate to techno-orientalist perspectives is that not only Western capitalist hierarchies are beneficiaries of such perspectives, but Eastern capitalist hierarchies, as integrated into a global system of capitalism, are perhaps even greater beneficiaries of techno-orientalism. Techno-orientalism, therefore, discloses to the West the threat-value dichotomy of the East, as largely embodied in the rise of a technologically advanced Chinese superpower that has adapted to the modernity and hierarchies of the West to far greater extents. As the political philosopher and international relations scholar Joseph Gregory Mahoney states, China has rapidly developed as an advanced technological society. This development is vital for independence and security, but also a key source of global technological culture. This transformation is not confirmed solely by China's advances in technologies, for example, quantum computing, artificial intelligence, green energy and space exploration, or social media. Rather, in tandem with China's advanced social and political organization, we can note the widespread presence of the modern cogito consciousness, all of which reflect industrial ratiocination, industrial production, industrial education, and so on, and all of which are consistent with a modern technological society. The threat-value dichotomy in the wake of China's rise in the 21st century can be observed on the one hand in the operations of American companies in China, who seek to utilize the nation's extensive labor force for developing American technologies, whilst on the other hand, American techno-nationalist rhetoric amongst the likes of Peter Thiel and Donald Trump have increasingly come to see China's technological capacities as a threat to American hegemony. Through the lens of American techno-nationalism, therefore, China is frequently invoked as having gained its technological achievements at the expense of the West, with allegations of state and corporate espionage. and that China can only pursue technological advancements for totalitarian means. As the Chinese technological researcher Yunying Huang suggests, according to techno-orientalist stereotypes, China is a site of extreme copy and counterfeit culture, as a place where students study, robot-like, without the capacity for critical thought, and as the home of intensive labor factories. Furthermore, China is home to a generic communist horde that threatens to imitate and potentially steal and undermine Western techno-hegemony. Based upon initial sinological orientalist expectations at the end of the 20th century and at the beginning of the 21st century, it was believed by the West, and the United States in particular, that a globally integrated China could only develop to become a modern liberal nation-state that would not seek to challenge the hegemony of the West. This Western-imposed expectation has since been shattered, as China, under the leadership of the Chinese Communist Party and Xi Jinping, has sought to define its national destiny in opposition to Western hegemony. The technological arms race between China and the United States is additionally a part of such a dialectical process, as American companies, with the intent of strengthening neoliberal hegemony through the logic of global free market capitalism, have participated in developing and facilitating China's own technological capacities. In 2005, the American data storage company named Seagate Technology engaged in for-profit collaboration with the Chinese state, which assisted in establishing the hard drive for China's first mass surveillance system. In more recent years, the American scientific technology company named Thermo Fisher Scientific again engaged in for-profit collaboration, providing the necessary DNA sequencing kits to Chinese authorities engaged in surveillance operations of the Uyghur population in the Xinjiang region. In the current day, American tech companies ranging from Google, Meta, Microsoft, and IBM are operational within China, engaged in corporate collaboration with Chinese tech companies for the development of AI technologies. And Elon Musk has reallocated a significant branch of Tesla's manufacturing to China and Asia broadly. Seemingly greater levels of collaboration between the United States and China is, however, also synchronized with the Biden administration's continuation of the Trump-era's economic trade war tariffs and growing military hostilities between the two countries regarding Taiwan and the South China Sea. The very presence of American tech companies in China have also raised national security concerns over technological espionage and collaboration with the Chinese military, leading the American entrepreneur and venture capitalist Peter Thiel to declare in an article for the New York Times that AI is a military technology. It is valuable to any army to gain an intelligence advantage, for example, or to penetrate defenses in the relatively new theater of cyber warfare, where we are already living amid the equivalent of a multinational shooting war. According to the technology researcher Neil Selwyn, American and broadly Western perceptions of technological innovation have long remained enthralled to East Asia. Regarding Chinese developments in artificial intelligence, Selwyn states that China is now widely considered to be leading the development of artificial intelligence. Western news media, policy and public opinion perpetuate a sense that China is dominating artificial intelligence and variations thereof. The ways in which AI is discussed and imagined in the West therefore continues to lean heavily on the notion that AI is being done by the Chinese in different, more rapid and efficient ways. Crucially, the most fundamental contradiction at the core of techno-orientalist anxieties, fears, and dichotomies regarding a rising China is that the United States, no matter how it seeks to define itself in opposition to China's rising technological hegemony, is itself inseparable from facilitating the rise of a technologically advanced Chinese hegemon in the 21st century. If Japan is a screen on which the West has projected its technological fantasies, then China is a screen on which the West projects its fears of being colonized, mechanized, and instrumentalized in its own pursuit of technological dominance. Indeed, as China continues to rise into the 21st century, techno-orientalist perspectives are likely to both suggest that China and Asia broadly are at the center of technological cultivation for Western companies eager to learn from the ways of a seemingly modern technological civilization, all while simultaneously invoking China's global technological capabilities as illiberal and draconian, contrasting the technologically enthralled Chinese subject with the economically redundant and technologically overwhelmed Western subject, who has been technologically colonized by China. Whilst techno-orientalism has notably derived from traditional Western-directed understandings upon the East, comprehensive techno-orientalist discourses of the 21st century are facilitated as much in the West as they are by the techno-centric practices in the East, as a part of a global capitalist techno-culture. In a 2016 article for the Financial Times named Why Singapore's Kids Are So Good at Maths, the journalist Vivan Vazagar recalls an interview with a Singaporean bank executive who suggests that the Singaporean education system creates machine-like learning patterns amongst students, suggesting in his own words that the Singaporean education system stifles someone's ability to think for themselves. They are like robots. They cannot think out of the box. While such frustrations with the Singaporean education system are also broadly reflected within largely Western assumptions about East Asia, there is far greater nuance to the manner in which Confucian social organization and modern technologies merge within East Asian societies. Whilst it is undeniable that countries such as Japan are investing heavily into robotic industries and further integrating robots into Japanese society to perform roles otherwise performed by humans, the vestiges of traditional conservatism, as seen largely amongst Japan's proficient aging population, might not establish Japan as the cyberpunk future it is typically attributed to become. As the Asian studies scholar Christopher Simmons suggests, while Japan is a world leader in robotics, the widespread deployment of AI in Japan may end up looking quite different when compared to other countries. Four key reasons for this include Japan's devotion to human employment as an essential component of social welfare, an intense work ethic that already ensures a supply of robotic labor in human form, a strong focus on AI and robotics development for nursing and social care, and problematic attitudes towards sexuality. Perhaps engaging in techno-orientalist language himself, Simmons nonetheless makes the argument that Japanese society is in many ways still hostile to robotic societal integration and will possibly not be the epicenter of a flourishing techno-culture, typically associated with the cyberpunk genre as a result of Japan's aging population and withstanding conservative features. In addition to Japan, other East Asian countries, such as China or South Korea, are also likely to face the challenges of maintaining dynamic techno-cultures, as both nations possess pressing societal wealth inequalities, gender inequalities, and rural-urban divides. Furthermore, the notions of techno-cultures or of technologically advanced societies are by no means unique to East Asia alone. For the mid to late 19th century, Japanese reformers of the Meiji period, such as Okubu Toshimichi, Ito Hirobumi, Kido Takayoshi, and most notably, Fukuzawa Yukichi, who is currently on the 10,000 yen Japanese banknote, look towards the techno-cultures of the West as a means towards modernization, so as to bind what they considered the Japanese spirit with Western techniques. Whilst many reformers of the Meiji period internalized the Western Orientalism of the mid to late 19th century, believing certain aspects of their own cultures and technologies to be backwards and unfit for the modern world, they thus projected their own form of techno-occidentalism, which suggested that emulating Western modernity was the only trajectory for Japanese societal progress. For others, however, such as the renowned Japanese novelist Natsume Soseki, who had spent 2 years of his life in Britain, initially admiring the country in his youthful days, returned to warn his fellow countrymen against the excesses of industrialization, for which he had experienced in London. Regarding the impact of industrialization on London, Soseki described the London masses as shadowy figures whom were smothered amongst the smoke of their own industrial technology, or in his own words declared, "I am the most inactive particle in the midst of these blackly moving objects. It is as though every single person's existence has been extinguished in this great darkness, and both shadow and form are no longer, and it is totally quiet." Perhaps foreseeing Japanese imperialism and the techno-nihilistic features of contemporary Japanese society today, Suzuki saw in Western modernity the effects of massification, for which individuals are reduced to mere shadows among shadows. While Suzuki was writing in the early 20th century, concerns regarding the influence of rationalism, individualism, and Western technology on Japanese society would continue throughout the 20th century. Following from Japan's defeat in the Second World War, the contemporary Italian Marxist philosopher Maurizio Lazzarato argues that Japanese society was faced with a crisis of subjectivity, stating that Japan came out of the Second World War completely destroyed, under long-term occupation, both socially and psychologically decimated, with no material assets, no raw materials, no reserve capital. What explains the economic miracle? They rebuilt a prodigious capital of subjectivity, capital in the form of knowledge, collective intelligence, the will to survive, etc. Indeed, they invented a new type of subjectivity, out of the devastation itself. The Japanese, in particular, recovered aspects of their archaic subjectivity, converting them into the most advanced forms of social and material production. The latter represents a kind of industrial complex for the production of subjectivity, one enabling a multiplicity of creative processes to emerge, certain of which are, however, highly alienating. As the state Shintoist ideology of Imperial Japan in the early to mid-20th century was abolished during the Allied occupation, Japan's post-war capitalist elite, in coordination with the United States, sought to remake Japanese subjectivity as condition to the capitalist modernism of post-war Japan. By the 1960s, however, Japan, according to the Japanese studies scholar Patrick James Noonan, was experiencing a period of social and political stability. High economic growth followed quashed social and labor movements, and a single political party, the Liberal Democratic Party, maintained rule from 1955 until 1993. Prime Minister Ikeda Hayato's famous doubling of the gross national product in the early part of the decade led to unprecedented employment rates and increased the average standard of living. This economic boom financed infrastructural changes that altered the nation's urban and rural landscapes, while cities were organized around ease of transportation and consumption. Integral to these developments were discourses of time, place, and community, which, like any period or place, were ideological in character. The establishment of a new post-war Japanese subjectivity, which was constructed in opposition to both imperial superstition and communist fervor, sought to sublimate pre-war notions of national pride and Confucian collectivism into modern liberal notions of societal arrangement and corporatism, which additionally correlated with the material changes taking place throughout post-war Japanese society. As Noonan declares, rebuilding a globally competitive capitalist economy at this time involved representing Japan's past, present, and future through narratives of teleological development. The devastation of the war was portrayed as laying the foundation for post-war prosperity. Popular and official discourse promoted a linear image of history that reduced the war to nothing more than a necessary condition for Japan's present-day prosperity. In 1964, Japan had ostensibly caught up with the post-war industrialized nations and was ahead of other Asian nations. At this time, the nation became increasingly cast as a homogeneous entity with a coherent, stable history. The economic demands of the government and corporations required men devote themselves to their places of employment, while women were asked to return to roles in the home. The government re-established mandatory ethics trainings for children in 1959, and in 1965, the Ministry of Education released its edict. The image of the ideal Japanese, which advanced a number of ideals resembling those promoted in pre-war proclamations, most conspicuously, filial piety and love for the nation. Through refashioning various sectors of post-war Japanese society, such as education, media, industry, urban space, family life, and the workplace, post-war Japan constructed a new type of subjectivity, which was, according to Noonan, complicit with a Confucian-orientated routine work ethic, consumerist lifestyle, regulated nationalism, anti-communism, and American hegemony. In other words, post-war Japanese capitalism was reflected in the subjectivities of its host population, which produced and reproduced ways of life that maintained capitalist hierarchies. Similar to the worker-employer system of American Fordism throughout the 20th century, which enforced a standard mode of conformity for workers and disenfranchised union activities, Japan's post-war subjectivity came to be aligned with the industrial system of Toyotism, as coined after the automotive manufacturing company named Toyota, which emphasized a regime of workplace efficiency, long-term employment, labor regulations, loyalty to the firm, and economic national pride. Regarding the formulation of capitalist subjectivities across the globe, Lazzarotto declares that capitalism launches subjective models the way the automobile industry launches a new line of cars. Indeed, the central project of capitalist politics consists in the articulation of economic, technological, and social flows with the production of subjectivity in such a way that political economy is identical with subjective economy. In this sense, the utilization of technology is also reflected in a society which emphasizes highly rationalized and regimented routine ways of life, which therefore produces deeply alienating and mechanized relations to technology. According to the Japanese studies scholar Saori Shibata, whilst Japan's post-war reindustrialization efforts required greater commitments of its population to furthering economic growth and national recovery, such a misbalanced work-life routine during Japan's neoliberalization process in the late 20th and early 21st century amounted to the further alienation of workers, who found themselves with far less control over the labor process and were subject to greater control by machines and devices. For the post-war nations of Japan, South Korea, and China, the discourses of technology were of crucial importance for the rebuilding and reindustrialization efforts of their respective war-torn societies. For post-war China, under the leadership of Mao Zedong, technology presented the revolutionary means to enhance the workers' lives, overcome scarcity, remold nature to the requirements of a communist civilization, and to defend the nation from imperialist powers. Technology in the early years of Maoist China was fundamentally considered to be a liberating tool of the proletariat, which served the interests of the Chinese Communist Party in the abolishment of feudalism and capitalism. The revolutionary technocentrism of Maoist China, however, would later pave way for its amending under the reforms of Deng Xiaoping in the late 1970s, who remained committed to a vision of Chinese technocentrism under the condition of which it maintained China's entry into the global free market system and supported rapid economic growth under a capitalist hierarchy. As the anthropologist and Chinese studies scholar Susan Greenhalgh makes clear, in the late 1970s, the new reform regime of Deng Xiaoping abandoned class struggle in favor of rapid economic growth and entry into the global capitalist system. From the outset of the reform era, the management of China's population has been a key plank in the regime's strategy of capitalist-style development and global ascent. The population project was biopolitical to the core, involving governing the biological body of the nation through science and technology. Through the use of modern population science and reproductive technology, the regime would take control of these domains, fashioning a population of optimal size and attributes that would both facilitate and symbolize China's status as a growing force in world affairs. Ensuring the mass mobilization of the vast Chinese populace to undertake efficient technologically enhanced economic procedures in often disparaging working conditions was of critical importance for Dengist China in the late 20th century. According to Greenhalgh, the maintenance of China's state capitalist system and rising global status required greater institutional knowledge over the lives of its working population as human capital, from which she declares that, with the global shift toward a knowledge economy, in which knowledge is the new source of the wealth of nations and the foundation of national strength, it became clear to China's leaders that in order to sustain growth, meet the demands of a highly competitive global economy, and consolidate the global gains made so far, it was imperative to start laying the foundations for a shift to a knowledge-based economy. China's reform leaders had already laid the groundwork for that shift in successive waves of policies aimed at supporting modern science, technology, and education. Building a new knowledge economy involved, according to World Bank advisors to the Chinese government, the formation of an institutional regime, information infrastructure, and innovation system supporting the creation and effective use of new knowledge. It also involves strengthening the nation's human capital. Indeed, human capital, capital embodied in humans in the form of health, education, skills, talent, savvy, and most generally, the ability to create and use knowledge effectively, is the very foundation of a knowledge economy, the factor that, again, according to World Bank advisors, will determine China's competitive edge. For Greenhalgh, certain features of China's knowledge-based regime included the management of education, health, welfare, fertility rates, work-life, family life, urban planning, media, and in cultivating desires, public figures, celebrities, narratives of a unified national identity and national destiny. In addition to nurturing efficient government responses to crises, pandemic controls, policing, and surveillance. In this respect, through the employment of a carefully crafted state capitalist subjectivity, endowed in habits, desires, relations, expressions, and worldviews, which are complicit with a capitalist hierarchy, China effectively molded its mass labor force to meet the demands of its state capitalist system. This understanding of a knowledge-based power which has only become more pervasive upon the ascendancy of digital technologies and communications in the 21st century, is most typically attributed to the works of the French philosopher Michel Foucault, who equated modernity with totalizing systems of control, reinforced through unrestrained biopolitical knowledge acquisition and governmentality, as manifested in modern institutions such as schools, hospitals, and prisons, and so forth, all of which were fueled by the psychological and physical disciplining of the body. As Foucault declared in his own words, "What we are dealing with in this new technology of power is not exactly society, nor is it the individual as body. It is a new body, a multiple body, a body with so many heads that, while they might not be infinite in number, cannot necessarily be counted." Biopolitics deals with the population as a political problem, as a problem that is at once scientific and political, as a biological problem and as a powers problem. For Foucault, biopolitics, at least as we understand it in the current day, is not so much concerned with apprehending individual subjects for the imposition of power on an individual level, but rather individual subjects and their biological and or psychological features are measured and apprehended on the level of populations, encompassing a network of institutions, such as intellectual, medical, religious, state, and market-based institutions. Biopolitics is also not limited to any given region, epoch, or hierarchy. In this sense, biopolitics, as an epistemologically grounded power structure, is historically contingent and in a persistent state of transformation. For Foucault, however, the Enlightenment period, starting in the 17th century, marked the emergence of a new kind of knowledge, grounded in highly sophisticated disciplines of measurement, arrangement, calculation, and scientific observation. Such a refined epistemological understanding of the world were most typified in the scientific illustrations of the Enlightenment period, which covered a variety of disciplines from biology to medicine to technology and natural history. For Foucault, the ability to regiment and present things in exquisite and magnified detail, often as dissected objects, revealing both interior and exterior faculties, provided new forms of scientific understanding or discourses about the world. As a feature of modernity, such discourses entailed that the world as an object of analysis is more comprehensible, predictable, and fundamentally controllable, converging with the domains of social, political, and economic power in relation to the prevailing systems of Western mercantile capitalism in the 17th and 18th centuries. Discourses of statistics, demography, epidemiology, and psychology provided modern nation-states the ability to govern their respective populations with greater efficiency through the practices of exclusion, normalization, disciplining, therapeutics, and optimization. Regarding the political knowledge of humans in particular, or as what Foucault declares in one of his notable lectures at the Collège de France, that biopower is the set of mechanisms through which the basic biological features of the human species became the object of a political strategy, of a general strategy of power. Or in other words, how, starting from the 18th century, modern Western societies took on board the fundamental biological fact that human beings are a species. Regarding the attentive disciplinary application of biopower, Foucault in a later lecture suggests that discipline analyzes and breaks down. It breaks down individuals, places, time, movements, actions, and operations. It breaks them down into components such that they can be seen, on the one hand, and modified on the other. Discipline classifies the components thus identified according to the definitive objectives. What are the best actions for achieving a particular result? What is the best movement for loading one's rifle? What is the best position to take? What workers are best suited for a particular task? What children are capable of obtaining a particular result? In other words, biopower as a disciplinary force ensures that humans are molded to think, act, behave, and relate to specific places, environments, objects, symbols, and sounds in ways in which maintain self-regulating, pattern-like efficiency. In the current day, a variety of institutions, from militaries to prisons, hospitals, modeling agencies, and social media platforms, maintain such a dominion over the body and the regimes of thought and life which follow in conjunction. Crucially, all modern institutions and modern societies have inherited this Enlightenment tradition of knowledge, for which nature and technology continues to yield ever more to the efficiency of global capitalist systems and hierarchies. The human relation to technology, therefore, is just one aspect of how biopolitics and or biopower direct certain ways of engaging with technology. For the 21st century, technological practices, whether in the West or in this case East Asia, are situated within broader, highly advanced systems of capitalist control, which maintain particular subjectivities on how people relate to and utilize such technologies for the benefit of maintaining and reproducing a capitalist system. Furthermore, technological practices in the East do not occur independently of the West, as Western corporate hegemony in Asia frequently facilitates the conditions which lead to expressions of alienation and roboticism. In 2018, an Apple Watch production factory in the Chinese city of Chongqing was under investigation by a Hong Kong-based NGO, as unpaid student interns in the factory, who were learning for their vocational degrees, expressed their dissatisfaction with the working conditions of the factory. According to a report by the Guardian newspaper, one of the unpaid student workers declared that, "We are like robots on the production lines. We repeat the same procedure for hundreds and thousands of times every day, like a robot." The US tech company Apple has additionally been scrutinized for its relation to Foxconn, also known as Honghai Technology Group, which is a prominent Taiwanese electronics manufacturing company that is active in the south of China, for assisting in the development of Apple Watches. The manufacturing operations conducted by the Taiwanese company in China were accused by human rights organizations of maintaining poor working conditions, excessive working hours, and draconian workplace rules, for which one report concluded that the workers were treated inhumanely, like machines. In May 2010, labor protests broke out against the cruel working conditions of Foxconn in the city of Shenzhen, which had, in a five-month period, led 13 factory workers to attempt suicide, and with 10 deaths resulting from such attempts. One labor activist outside of the company headquarters in the Taiwanese capital of Taipei declared that, "We urge Foxconn to respect life and to stop its inhuman and militarized treatment of workers aimed at maximizing profits. The workers have to stand all day, and they are not allowed to talk. They are treated almost like machines, in a sweatshop environment." In a report on the mistreatment of migrant Chinese workers in Foxconn facilities, the communication studies scholar Kristen Lucas, Dongjin Kang, and Zhao Li quote a frontline worker who directly shared her automated, machine-like experience at the assembly line. "I am the quality evaluator. I am placed in the iron chair, tied by static lines. When the reflow delivers me the cell phone motherboards repeatedly, I take it with two hands, and then shaking my head from right to left, moving my eye from left to right, up and down. It never ends. If I found it is deficient or anything wrong with it, I will shout loudly, 'AOI,' or 'iron board.' Another spare part of the machine like me will immediately run to me and ask about the reason and then regulate the line." Recalling the harsh conditions of Foxconn factories in southern China, the journalist Stephanie Wong stated that, "Most of the young workers come from rural areas, where interpersonal relationship plays an important role in their social life. However, interpersonal relationship, or even communications, is not encouraged at Foxconn. Workers say that they are not allowed to talk at work. While most of them live in the factory dormitory, workers from the same shift or the same department would not be assigned into the same room. Some call it as military management, while some suspect such an arrangement is to avoid workers building up friendship or furthermore, getting organized." To this day, worker protests in Foxconn facilities continue to occur, as human and worker rights are still to be reconciled in China. The US tech giant's association with Foxconn manufacturing reveals that exploitation and the alienated machine-like experiences of workers rests within a global network of power structures, where no single source is entirely accountable, as Foxconn relies equally as much on the pressure from Apple and foreign investors who are themselves indebted to China's suppressive labor laws. Additionally, the iPhone itself, as Apple's main product, is made from processing rare earth materials in Mongolia, camera lenses in Japan, and batteries and microprocessors in South Korea. China is the final assembly site for the global factory. Furthermore, the automation of labor for companies such as Foxconn also remains a focal point of interest to enhance production efficiency and to maximize company profits, as the Chinese state additionally seeks to move away from being the world's factory to an economic producer of advanced technological goods by 2025. The reallocation of cheap labor production, however, is currently shifting into greater areas of the global south. Rapid technological innovation and advancements in the 21st century has coined the term the Fourth Industrial Revolution, which most specifically refers to the shift towards developments in artificial intelligence, gene editing, and advanced robotics, as they relate to transformations in industrial capitalism, and for where the line between physical, digital, virtual, and biological worlds becomes seemingly blurred. While such advancements are likely to enhance certain aspects of the human condition and provide greater levels of productivity, efficiency, and improved quality of life for some, one of the most immediate threats of such advancements is the process of automation, which is threatening to upend human labor and replace it with machines, which possess greater capacities for labor production. From labor-producing robots to self-driving automobiles and delivery drones, the advent of the fourth industrial revolution is reshaping the techno-societal landscape and concurrently intensifying wealth inequality, unemployment, and the stagnation of wages. Most specifically in the West, the specter of automation has fueled fears regarding the potential for an AI takeover. And in the worst cases, such anxieties have also bled into hostilities against migrants, refugees, and other groups of people, in often deeply resentful and conspiratorial ways, with China and/or the World Economic Forum typically presented as the penultimate enemies of the West, who are responsible for the West's decline and loss of blue-collar manufacturing jobs. What is usually overlooked from Western anxieties of automation, however, is which groups of people across the world are most vulnerable to automation and most vulnerable to being perceived as automata at the hands of largely Western global corporations. As the American economic historian Lewis Hyman declares of cheap labor production in that of his own country in the late 20th century, that every time someone says robot, simply picture a woman of color. Instead of self-aware robots, workers, all women, mostly immigrants, sometimes undocumented, hunched over tables with magnifying glasses, assembling parts, sometimes on a factory line, and sometimes on a kitchen table. According to Hyman, the economic boom of America's electronics industries in the late 20th century was largely facilitated by a non-unionized, cheap foreign workforce, notably made up of Mexicans, Asians, and Southern Europeans. Among the Asian demographics in the electronics industry included Chinese, Japanese, and Filipino laborers who had previously been fruit pickers in California throughout the early to mid 20th century. In the current day, Southeast Asia, particularly that of the Philippines, remains a central point for now Western tech companies to recruit largely female workers into jobs which cannot yet be accurately performed by robots or AI moderators. According to the media outlet Vice, there is an estimated 100,000 content moderators operational within the Philippines, with the majority of such moderators based in the Filipino capital of Manila, where they are responsible for data scrubbing and removing offensive materials from the internet and social media sites, such as Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, Google, and Twitter. Despite often outnumbering the employees of the original tech companies themselves, such moderators receive no personal benefits, low wages, and no recognition as real workers. In an article for the Washington Post regarding the hidden internet moderators of Manila, the journalists Elizabeth Dwoskin, Jean Wallen, and Regine Cabato reveal the profound psychological effects upon such workers, stating that current and former moderators in Manila described a workplace where nightmares, paranoia, and obsessive ruminations were common consequences of the job. Several described seeing colleagues suffer mental breakdowns at their desks. One of them said he attempted suicide as a result of the trauma. Several moderators call themselves silent heroes of the internet, protecting Americans from the ills of their own society, and say they've become so consumed by the responsibility of keeping the web safe that they look for harmful content in their free time to report it. The vulnerability of content moderators is most acute in the Philippines, one of the biggest and fastest growing hubs of such work and an outgrowth of the country's decades-old call center industry. The work places enormous burdens on them to understand foreign cultures and to moderate content in up to 10 languages that they don't speak, while making several hundred decisions a day about what can remain online. While many Filipino workers say they become content moderators because they thought it would be easier than customer service, the work is very different from other jobs because of the stress of hours and hours of exposure to people getting hurt, to animals getting hurt, and all sorts of hurtful, violent imagery. Other interviewed workers declared that they struggle to disassociate their everyday lives from the images they observe, with one worker declaring that he can no longer enter tall buildings due to triggering flashbacks of the suicides he witnessed online. In the name of internet safety, Filipino workers endure the most degenerate visuals of contemporary society, spending hours pressing either ignore or delete so that the rest of the world can maintain a largely sanitized internet experience. Perceived as seemingly sacrificial, emotionless, pain-absorbing, invisible machines, such Filipino workers are, in this context, both victims of techno-orientalist expectations and the continued systemic exploitation of the global south. In other parts of the world, migrant workers from the Philippines have been described as lifeless, vacant-eyed, and automatons, as seen in comments made by Israeli conservatives who are opposed to importing foreign labor. Inter-Asian techno-orientalism has also taken place against Filipino workers, as countries such as South Korea have utilized the Philippines' vast outsourced labor pool of largely female English speakers for voicing robot teachers due to a lack of English instructors in the country. What is known as the Enki robot in the presence of Korean classrooms allows for students to both interactively learn, play, sing, and dance with the robot, all whilst learning English, as the female Filipino teacher voices and controls the robot directly from the Philippines. Cameras tracking the teacher's face presents the movement of her face within the robot, but does not display the teacher's actual face, replacing her face with the animated face of a white woman upon the display of the robot. In South Korea, Englishness, or the capacity to speak English of any variation, is still largely associated with white appearances, despite of the fact South Korea relies heavily on automated, outsourced teachers from the Philippines due to the country's history of importing American English during the American colonial period. For the Asian studies scholar Ana Romina Guevara, the Enki robot is required to remain more robot than human, and the Filipino teachers are required to think and refer to themselves as the Enki robot, presenting a non-Filipino face, for which Guevara states, Enki's success in the classroom depends on the fact that she is perceived to be a plaything and less threatening than an actual human teacher. The kind of labor performed by these robot teachers and the consciousness they inhabit must balance a fine line between being human-like yet still appearing to be a thing, an entertaining gadget. According to Guevara, one of the Filipino teachers described the disembodied automated experience as a rather alienating process, for which the teachers can never truly reveal themselves to the children for fear of breaking the illusion of a self-controlled robot and being perceived as inauthentic. In the United States, the multinational technology and e-commerce company Amazon, which is itself renowned for inducing alienation amongst its workers, who have claimed to be treated as no more than machines, launched in 2005 the new business model known as Amazon Mechanical Turk, which relies on non-office workers from across the world to fulfill a variety of crowdsourcing tasks and assignments, so as to generate on-demand algorithmic data for a plethora of businesses, with payments ranging from 3 cents to 30 cents or more, depending on the task at hand. The name Mechanical Turk is in itself a traditional Orientalist term, which referred to a human-like puppet which was garbed in Turkish attire and fraudulently won games and chess, being merely a part of a machine which was controlled by someone else. The Turkish presentation in this sense reaffirmed late 18th and early 19th century Western notions of Turks being docile and soulless. The name for the 21st century implies a seemingly hidden power relation for which humans are reduced to such mechanical puppets, serving largely Western companies and engaged in work which can otherwise be performed by machines. As the journalist Miranda Hall reaffirms, the pipe-smoking Turk from which Amazon's micro-work platform gets its name was part of a craze for automata designed to resemble the Oriental Other, the docile and obedient Muslim of Christian theology. But the Muslim as machine takes on new meanings as workers in impoverished areas, from Syrian refugee camps to the Palestinian occupied territories, are forced to perform these repetitive, unskilled tasks, concealed behind a slick, anonymized interface. Machine-like, always on, this surplus population can always be tapped into by companies to fuel the 24-hour business cycle that drives Western progress. Whilst Amazon Mechanical Turk is officially offered to anybody across the globe, the vast majority of Amazon Mechanical Turk users are from economically precarious areas of the global south, most specifically from India, further nurturing the datification of human life. The site also tracks the motion of the user's answers, ensuring that the users respond with thoughtful accuracy and precision, as opposed to recklessly answering questions at random. Crucially, at the core of largely global south-orientated techno-orientalist paradigms, labor-bound Asian populations remain objectified as seemingly techno-humans of difference, within a global capitalist system for which, according to the author Martin Kevorkian, non-white work may be performed interchangeably under the sign of automation, either by dark-skinned servants to technology or subsequently by fleshless technological servants. In contrast to the more negative effects associated with techno-orientalism, some contemporary scholars have argued that features typically associated with the East in the Western imagination have been either directly or indirectly adopted by Asian societies to cultivate a type of self and/or counter-orientalism, as seen in the phenomena of South Korea's thriving pop culture industry and Japan's significant manga and anime industries. Self or counter-orientalism in this sense serves to capture the Western and global imagination of the East, for which is otherwise inauthentic, hyper-fantasized, and or built upon a tradition of external projections of the Orient. Regarding Japan in particular, the anthropologist Brian Moran suggests that, far from allowing themselves to remain subordinate to Western hegemony in the Orientalist discourse, the Japanese have actively involved themselves in propagating an ethno- or counter-Orientalism, in which they have taken many of the negative qualities assigned to Oriental peoples by Orientalists and converted them into positive evaluations of their own society and culture. For other scholars, such as the Japanese media and culture studies scholar Koichi Iwabuchi, any form of self or counter-Orientalism is so indebted to the traditional legacy of Western Orientalism, Asian societies will never be able to fully reclaim Orientalist constructions without engaging in their own subjection to inauthentic presentations of the East. Whilst Asia has largely remained at the center of Western post-human conceptions, such techno-orientalist paradigms are reflected in a diversity of understandings, with Asian populations coming to be presented as both the masters and servants of technology. However, for the current day, techno-orientalist perspectives are by no means limited to the perceptions of the West, but rather such perceptions can be shared and disseminated by anyone, even by Asian people themselves, for a variety of reasons and purposes, in a globally connected and intertwined world. The consequences of technological advancement, as brought forth from the Fourth Industrial Revolution, are also not limited to the region of Asia alone, as expressions of roboticism, techno-nihilism, and alienation are permeated throughout the world, as a part of broader systemic realities associated with the human condition under capitalism. Moreover, as new Asian hegemons and superpowers are emerging in what is considered the Asian century, the legacy of Orientalism is potentially likely to be challenged by the rise of Occidentalism, as China, with greater capacities for self-definition, is already defining and essentializing the West in terms of irrationality, inefficiency, and nepotism. However, as China's technological capacities continue to increase, especially in terms of military prowess and mass surveillance, Orientalist and techno-orientalist frameworks are undoubtedly bound to be kept alive and reshaped to meet the challenges of China's growing hegemony in the 21st century. Crucially, the paradigms of humanness and post-humanness are in a persistent state of transformation, especially as the line between East and West continues to blur through greater advances in globalization. So long as paradigms, perspectives, and ideologies continue to frame the other in terms of technological efficiency or deficiency, the impartiality of linear technological progress must certainly be brought into question.